cold out, windy out, who does it affect, pitchers or hitters?
You know, it depends on what's going on the field. Now, from a pitching standpoint, if the wind is in your face or a little bit of a swirling crosswind, the Tanaka splitter is going to move all over the place. You know, I used to pitch at Candlestick Park, and I loved pitching there because when you throw into the wind or with a crosswind, your slider breaks like crazy. So does your splitter. So that can help and hurt you at the same time because you've got to get it over the plate, you know, and throw strikes with it. But pitchers, you have to deal with the movement on your pitches being more than what you're used to.
How about batters? Are they at a disadvantage when it's cold?
Yeah, a little bit. I don't think it's quite cold enough. It's just more blustery. You know, it's still around 50 degrees. When it gets down to in the upper 30s and 40s, and then, you know, range of motion gets inhibited. So, yeah, the extension on everything, pitchers' extension on their fastballs, hitters' extension on their swings, then that comes into play.
Now, the big conversation is trying to get length out of Tanaka and really all of your starters, because you might have to go four straight days and you could really tax your bullpen. And nobody's pitched, you know, three straight days out of this bullpen during the course of the year. But do you think they'll treat Tanaka differently? Do you think the scenario is exactly the same as it was in the first game, where 68 pitches, goes through the order through six? Does he bring him out for the seventh, or did he stick to the game plan of not wanting to have his starting pitchers go three times through the order?
You know, I think he's going to give them a little slack on the leash tonight, so to speak, but it still depends on how the game situation is going at that time, how well he's throwing, what Houston's doing, and this is a must-win game. I'm not worried about four straight games. You might not get to the fourth game at this point. You've got to win tonight, and really tomorrow in my mind as well. If you win tonight, then you put some pressure on Verlander tomorrow, and you get to face Verlander in your home park. Yeah, now you could see a way to the end, and you know, if you could steal that one from Verlander, then Gerrit Cole on short rest. Boy, you've really flipped the script. I'm not worried about four straight days. You got to get to four straight days. Tonight is a must-win.
There's a story that we just covered. Andy Martino of SNY does a great job. Said that the Yankees were upset with whistling from the Astros' dugout, and a GM that didn't give his name said that's breaking an unwritten rule. The only problem I would have, if they're whistling to relay signs that were gotten illegally through technology, have you ever heard that you can't whistle from the dugout?
Well, I think, you know, it becomes a big bluff, a big poker game at this point, where you're trying to use, you know, the bluff as getting into the opponent's heads, and it's kind of working. And I actually saw Aaron Judge do something in the dugout in game two where, you know, they're like looking at some sort of a script and they're looking at the camera, and it's almost like everybody's into a big bluff game. It's almost become a big joke at this point. But yes, using technology, back to the Apple Watch with the Boston Red Sox a couple of years ago, yeah, that's a big no-no. You can't use a monitor and then use an iPhone or an Apple Watch and try to relay signs. And that's so tough to do anyway.
But let's say their bench coach, Joe Espada, picks up a tell on the pitcher. And they say, oh, this is when he does this. He throws a fastball. And somebody whistles to tell. Is that wrong?
Well, you know, that you're getting into the gray area, you know, and from a pitching standpoint, you could start to say, you know what, I'm going to throw one high and tight, you know, to send a message, and that's gamesmanship too.
Right.
So, yeah, that's when you're getting into the blurred lines of gamesmanship at that point.
All right, so many guys slumping, right? Sanchez slumping, Encarnacion, DD. I mean, which one are you the biggest concern about, just as far as you're afraid that this is something that might last right till the end?
Well, you know, I think if you're basing a slump on facing the two most dominating right-handed pitchers in the American League, and you're thinking, well, maybe we need to make a change. Well, who are you going to put in there that's going to hit
right.
a Gerrit Cole slider?
Know
you know,
sure.
I mean, you know, is it a slump or is it Verlander and Cole? And they put Greinke in that category, too. He gave up three runs. He's still, you know, a great pitcher with a great pedigree. So, yeah, I mean, are they slumping or are they great pitches? You know, I saw Cole make some of the best sliders I've seen him make all year long, and in particular on Gary Sanchez. And sometimes pitchers do that. When you have a hitter that's down a little bit, and I did it when I pitched, it's like, oh, boy, it gives you a little confidence, and you break out your best sliders against those hitters because you don't want to let them up. You kind of smell blood, so to speak. So, you know, I give credit to Cole and some of those nasty breaking balls he was throwing.
We had a narrative at the start of the show. Callers calling in constantly. They've got a Ben Sanchez for Romine. Mark Teixeira laughed it off. Let me ask you, would you even think about it?
No, definitely not. You know, and You know, Zach Greinke threw a ball 95 miles an hour in the dirt the other night. There's no way you can catch that ball. There's no
Zach
way
Britton.
You can. Yeah, Zach Britton, yeah. Rather. Zach Britton did. And, you know, catchers block breaking balls in the dirt. They don't block 95-mile-an-hour sinkers in the dirt. So forget about the pass ball. That was a wild pitch. The wild pitch of all wild pitches. So, you know, Sanchez can still have a Reggie night. Would you be surprised if Sanchez hit three home runs tonight? I don't think anybody would be surprised if that happened. He may strike out three times as well. Zach Greinke may make great pitches on him. They're great pitchers. That happens in postseason. We see it all the time. That great pitchers make great pitches. You know, hitters are going to strike out or they're not going to do well.
I'd be more surprised by the three home runs, David, only because I'm not remotely for benching Gary Sanchez, but he has appeared lost. To me, it's not just that he hasn't been making contact. There were some at-bats where he downright didn't look close.
Well, that's a valid point. I mean, certainly confidence is a big part of this game. Confidence is very fleeting for even the best of athletes. Yes, it happens. But, you know, I thought that, you know, watching him against Cole in particular, let's just narrow it down to the most recent game. Well, I really saw some nasty breaking balls. And the last time up, you know, Gary, even though he hit it on the ground, he hit it 107 miles an hour on the ground right at the shortstop. I thought that was a pretty good swing. I think Aaron Boone is right. He's missing his pitches. We've seen him right on some pitches and foul them straight back up off the screen. And, you could say, yeah, hey, well, it's a foul ball. Well, the timing was there on several swings that I saw. You just can't miss your pitch when you get it.
What's wrong with Ottavino?
You know, Ottavino's a little bit miscast in my mind. He's not a one-batter guy. You know, his stuff moves all over the place. It takes him a little while to find the radar, so to speak. And to bring him in for one hitter was really not his strength, I think. And the one thing about Ottavino is that got exposed the other night was how slow he is to home plate. And we actually saw a hit and run, or a run and hit, whatever you want to call it, with Altuve the other night. Kind of hit the ball in the hole when Glaber was covering, when Springer was trying to steal. And that's the problem with Ottavino, is that Springer and Altuve and that part of the lineup, if they're on base, but he can get exposed in the running game because he can't hold runners on.
I want to go back to Verlander and Cole for a second. You're right. They're both filthy. But wouldn't you say that Verlander in game two and what we saw Cole in game three, that there were moments they were hittable? That was not necessarily their A-plus games. Would you be concerned that they might even be tougher to hit the next time around?
You know, yeah, you could argue both ways. You know, I know that speaking from experience, they both got really used in the first round. They both had to pitch twice in a five-game series, and that took a lot of bullets out of them, and an emotional one for Cole in game five in the division series. So cumulatively, I think, you know, that might be the Yankees' best chance. That these guys are starting to get worn down. They both were well over 200 innings, a lot of strikeouts, a lot of deep games. Maybe this is a residual effect that may benefit the Yankees. They're both going to have to pitch twice in this round as well. And, you know, I think maybe their stuff is showing some signs of some wear and tear over a long year.
We're talking with my Yes Network colleague, David Cohn, former Yankee and Met as well, Cy Young Award winner. Before I let you go, let's play the what-if game. Let's say these two games are split, 3-2, going to Saturday. If you're Hinch, would you pitch Cole on 3 days' rest?
No.
If you're down 3-2. Now, you saw how Verlander pitched on 3 days' rest. It wasn't him. Would you do it?
Yes, I think you almost have to. If you're down 3-2, that's a tough decision because it's sort of like leaving your closer in the bullpen on the road in a tie game. Well, saving Cole for Game 7, but you don't get to Game 7.
Right.
So that is the ultimate choice for Hinch. You got to have an awful lot of confidence in your bullpen to do a bullpen day down 3-2, even though you're at home.
How tough is it for a pitcher that's used to pitching on 4 days' rest to pitch short?
Well, it's not tough. It's just that your stuff isn't quite as sharp. And we saw that with Verlander in game two. You know, I did it in 1992 in the playoffs when I was with the Blue Jays. And I pitched game two in the ALCS against the Oakland A's. Had one of my best games in postseason ever, I think, in game two of 92. Came back on short rest and got bombed. And my fastball was about a foot shorter. My slider didn't break. I didn't make quick adjustments. And I got knocked out of that game. So, yeah, it takes something out of your arm, especially when you're a power pitcher. Back in 92, I was a power pitcher. I was coming off of my Mets days, you know, and I wasn't the guy you saw at the end of my career with the Yankees. I saw that with Verlander pitching on short rest. His slider just didn't have the snap to it. And the same with Cole. Cole didn't have that riding action on his fastball. He only got three swings and misses on his four-seam fastball, which is one of the best, if not the best, fastball in the game right now.
That's why it's so important. You win today. If you could squeeze one out tomorrow, against Verlander, and then you're forcing them to use Cole on 3 days rest, and you know, flip the coin, see what he has.
Yeah, you flip the script, and I know you know you could. People say, well, the Yankees have to use their bullpen 4 days in a row. That's 4 days from now. I'm not worried about that. I think this is a positive for tonight because you get Tanaka back on the mound. He's your best pitcher going right now. Chad Green's already been used, so if you were going to use him as an opener last night, you were lucky to get one inning out of him in an opener as opposed to two. So in the short term, this is advantage Yankees. In the long term, if this goes to Game 7, it may catch up to the Yankees.